Hey, Ken Pooch Van Druten here. Today I'd like to take you through a little bit of my console and some super rack connections in my Iron Maiden file. In a previous video, we talked a little bit about my Iron Maiden Digico file, but now let's make those connections with super rack and have a look at how I set up my console and maybe some of the plugin choices that I use. So let's have a look. In an earlier video, I talked about some of the routing that I have going on in Digico. But now let's take that routing one more step and kind of see what the connection to Super Rack looks like so that you can see what's going on. So here's the kick drum. My two kick drums, 91 and 52, are routed to a group and then landed on a channel here, this kick channel. Then that kick channel has an insert on it, and that insert goes to the waves racks of Super Rack. So if we go over here to Super Rack and have a look-see, here's the kick channel in Super Rack. The first plugin in the chain is the SSL channel, which is one of my really, it's one of my favorites. I use it on drums all the time. It's a great plugin. Pretty standard, you know, I'm boosting about 60. Looks like I'm cutting about 250 and putting some click into it. If you notice, I'm not using the dynamic part of the SSL. I like that, like on snare drum and stuff and some other things. But for kick drum, you'll notice that my second plugin channel here is the DBX 160. It's one of my favorites as a analog unit. And I use it as a plugin all the time. It's great on drums. So there's that. And then the third thing is you have to remember that the kick drum for Iron Maiden is a enclosed kick drum. There's no sound hole in the front of it. So I use low air to manufacture just a little bit of low end just to give the kick have a little bit of oomph. So that's my three things on the kick drum. Let's go back over to here to Digico land. Let's have a look at the snare. The snare is the same way. It travels snare top and bottom, two channels. There is a little bit of EQ, you'll notice, but then it goes to a group and the group lands in this channel right here, the snare drum. It also has an insert on it. So if you look at the insert section, it is going to, again, to a waves channel. We go over here to the Super Rack. Let's have a look. The first plugin in the Super Rack channel for me is the DBX 160. Like it on kick and snare. It gives it, kick and snare, a lot of extra snap. One of my favorites. Then the next one is Torque Live. And if you aren't using Torque Live for your snare drum, you're really missing out. This is like literally one of my favorite new plugins. It allows you to kind of pitch shift a little bit and to kind of manufacture some low end in any sort of instrument. And in this case, it's the snare drum. And so I'm manufacturing a little bit of oomph, a little bit of the body of the snare drum gets manufactured by this Torque Live. You know, unfortunately, in all these examples, we don't have audio going on because I don't have a console. I'm using the offline, but try it out at home, man. I'm telling you, Torque Live is awesome for snare drum. Cool. All right, so let's go back to Digico and continuing onwards. We will look at the toms. All right, the toms are sourced from here. All kinds of toms, 9 of them are being sourced from there. You'll notice that the gates are there. I think I'm doing gates from the mustard, but the EQ is from the SD side. And that's really probably just a carryover from before. Like if I were starting again, I would probably do SD, I would do mustard EQ along with the gating. But anyway, you can have both. I mean, that's what's so rad about the new mustard in the spice rack and all that kind of stuff. You could have combinations of anything. So anyway, those are my toms right there, and they end up in a group, and then the group lands in a channel, and that's where this tom channel is from. Right here. And this tom channel also has waves insert on it. So let's go back and look at it. We look over here, and I have the SSL channel on the toms. Looks like I'm just adding a little bit of low end right there, not really doing a whole lot more to it. Maybe a little bit of compression as well on the overall toms bus, but that's about it. So that's that. Let's go back here to DigiGo Land, and you know, one thing that I do with the cymbals is I do like to have a C6 on the cymbals, or an F6. It depends, F6 or C6 on the cymbals. But I don't want them on this layer. You'll see why here in a second. So this cymbal group right here is actually where I'm sourcing the insert for the super rack. So we'll go back over here. You'll see this is also going to super rack. You go back over here and you look at this cymbals group, and I have a C6 on it. Looks like I had a little, there's a little thing going on. Maybe it's 700, but everything else is maybe just doing a little compression. Looks like at 8K, close to 8K. So that's in the cymbals when they get a little bit of get trashy and he's really bashing on them. I just wanted to tickle it a little bit. But let me show you, going back here to DigiGo Land, why I do those on the group as opposed to, you know, the toms were on that channel, but on the I want that on the group because it's a stereo C6, and then I return it to the overheads to have separate mono channels. And the reason that I do that is during the show, if anything gets a little wanky in the overall picture of the drums, in other words, the overheads feel like the shift of them feels weird, I want to be able to have control of that, to turn down the left or the right side just a little bit. Or for instance, maybe there's a song where he's really bashing on the right hand cymbal, and maybe just for that song I pull that down, or it's part of a snapshot. But I like to have separate control of that right at my fingertips, right there on my first layer. So that's why the super rack contains contains the group insert. And then you'll see good cop, bad cop. Those are my usual group stuff. You go over to here. Good cop, bad cop. So good cop is the normal kind of drum bus, and it you'll see it has an insert going to good cop, and then bad cop here as well. Come back over here, and it's your pretty standard stuff that I do. SSL comp. You'll notice on the good cop, you know, the threshold is down a little bit, and the actual ratio is only 2:1. But if you go and look at my bad cop, you'll notice that major threshold happening and ratio of 10:1. That's really my squash bus. So that's my parallel drum bus. We go back to DigiGo here, and I don't know if you remember me telling you in the older video, that kick and snare from the first layer go to good cop and bad cop. The toms from the first layer end up going to good cop and bad cop, and then good cop and bad cop go to drums, and then cymbals go to drums. So this toms group right here is actually the output of it is going to where is it going to? Oh, it's going to that channel. So if we go back and look at this again, this toms channel is being sourced from that group right there. Okay, so that's where that is then sent to good cop and bad cop. All right, I know it's a little confusing, but let me try to run it through you again. Okay, kick, snare, toms, those are all assigned to good cop and bad cop, and they all source from this channel layer. Those are all going to good cop, bad cop. Got it? All right. Then hats, overheads, and rides go to the cymbal group. And that cymbals group, which has a waves thing on the insert, goes to the drums bus. And so does good cop and bad cop. All right. So good cop, bad cop, and cymbals end up in the drums. And then you end up with the drums. Now, on the drums, I also have an insert. And if we go back here to the super rack, let's go look at that drum bus right here. I have a little F6 going on. There's nothing going through it right now. That's why it looks a little wanky. It's an RTA version. So when there's no signal going through it, it does a little wanky drawing thing. I am basically only messing with these two, 5 and 6. And it's just a little bit of compression that helps. Remember, I had that in the C6 in the cymbal bus. This is the overall drum bus that when the drums overall get kind of trashy, that's what these do. There's that. So I think we've seen all the drums. Oh, there's one little snare verb that I use as a as an effect for only one song. If you go back here and you look at my stuff, you'll see this one, snare gate. There's only one song that I use that in, and it is that particular plug, R verb. It's like a gated snare kind of a thing. So it's like a special. Most of the other reverbs are not plugins. They're coming from Bricasti. So I have two Bricastis that are on the drums. One's kind of a larger overall drum thing, and the other one is kind of a kick and a snare thing. So that's the drums. Let's have a look at some of my other stuff. Let's look at Steve Harris's bass. Okay, so all the way over here on the left is three inputs from Steve Harris: bass pre, bass mic, and bass effects. So both of these things, bass pre and bass effects, are DIs that are coming post out of his rig. So I'm getting like all of his processing and all of his stuff. If you're not familiar with his sound, there's a very distinct Steve Harris kind of bass tone. So those two things kind of help me to get that. But I really lean on this bass mic a lot. It's what's coming out of his cabinet is really like his sound. I tend to lean on that quite a bit. So if we go back over here to Super Rack Land, you'll see that I have a CLA 76 on the bass pre. This is the DI preamp send. So that's a CLA 76 modeled after an old 1176. Those are just amazing compressors. I use them all the time. I like the black face mostly. Sometimes I use blue, it depends. And then I'm using R bass on him just a little bit, just to kind of beef up the lows a little bit. You know, his tone is really cutting, and it's got like lots of great tonality to it, but I just felt like in a PA that it needed just a little bit more with the R bass. And then in the bass mic channel, I'm doing the CLA 76 again. That's my overall compressor of choice for bass guitar for pretty much. Here's kind of a weird thing. I'm using PSE to gate that channel. That's his microphone. And so I needed kind of a soft gate going on there when he's not playing. Like literally, this is the threshold of this is so far down that when he's playing, there's never any sort of gating or anything happening. But when he stops, his rig kind of sits there and makes noise. It kind of just sits there because it's a lot of old analog gear. It sits there just going shh. So I like the PSE for that kind of stuff. It's just a really handy gate and it works very well. So that's what's going on there. And then over here in the bass group, I'm using Vitamin. So if we go back over here to Digital Land, we can see where that's sourcing from. We go over here to the bass group and we have a look at it, and the insert of that is indeed going to bass group on the Super Rack. So if you haven't used Vitamin, it's really, really an interesting tool. It's kind of a way to spread out some frequencies, make sort of depth and frequency dependent shifting a little bit. It's really, really great. So if you look down here, you can kind of see there's a low mid, mids, high mids and highs, and these are the thresholds of adjusting of that with kind of crossover points of here. It looks like I'm doing some mid-range. I'm doing a little bit of frequency spreading compression kind of thing in the mid-range. I'm using that quite a bit. Not so much in the lows or the low mids. Maybe in the highs. It looks like I'm taking the highs and spreading them out a little bit. So anyway, that on the overall bass group after those three inputs just sounds really great. So that's the bass guitar. Steve Harris bass guitar sound is all coming from his rig. All I do is really turn it up. I have some effects and there's a little bit of compression, but for the most part, it's all him. How about some guitars? All right. I, with guitars, kind of my philosophy with guitars is I tend to use plugins on groups for guitars. So if we go over here and we have a look-see at Dave's group, well, here, I'll show you what Dave's channels look like. So here's all of Dave's channels right here. These are Adrian's, but these are Dave's channels. Let's see. There's a bunch of stuff with Dave. Basically, there's three microphones on there. And one's a 57 and forget what the other is. Oh, it's a Toll. That's right. Manufacturer from South Africa. It's a Toll microphone, T-U-L. It's a fantastic guitar microphone. I really love it. That's what's going on with him. These other two things are probably inputs that, I landed them, but they're inputs that like Tater and Monitors is probably using. So mainly I'm using the 57 and the Toll. Both of those then bus over to this guitar bus, Dave, which then has an insert on it, I believe. Yes, it does. We go back over here. We have a look at Dave guitar. One of my favorite compressors for guitar is the LA-3A. I used to use it analog-wise all the time. The CLA-3A is a model of it, and it's fantastic on guitar. You should try it. And then the overall group has a little bit of EQ on it with the C6, you can see. I'm doing some compression and some EQ to the overall guitar tone that's coming from those two channels that are combined. So that's Dave's group, man. Super simple. Let's go back to have a look-see at maybe Adrian. Yeah, all right. So Adrian also has a bunch of channels and a bunch of them are being used in monitors as well. But basically for Adrian, it is also, I believe, a 57 and a Toll. I am using a little bit of reverb on him that I'm manufacturing. So I felt like his tone was a little bit dry for the overall tone. So I thought I would just add a little bit of space to it. So that's what this guitar verb is. And that is sourced, you can see here on the aug sends, that's sent out here to, let's look at Adrian guitar verb right here. And it has an H verb on it. Very, very short time. Looks like, what's the pre-delay? 61. That's pretty standard for me. And pretty short time. You know, it's just making the guitar a little bit kind of bigger. That's it. It doesn't really get in the way of it, doesn't cloud it at all. It just gives it kind of bigger space. So that's that. But the these other two are you know, the Toll and the 57 are then being bused to the guitar world, guitar groups over here. If you look at Adrian and Adrian's insert on his group, goes over here, and we look at Adrian's guitar group. Here it is, and much like Dave's, it has the same thing, CLA 3A on it. Again, very cool, and a little bit different kind of EQ than what Dave had. His tone required a little bit of different adjusting. So a little EQ and a little bit of compression going on. Here, I'll show you. There's Dave's, and there's Adrian's. So you get the idea. And finally, let's have a look at Yannick's stuff. So Yannick has a bunch of stuff. He's got, I'm using a PDIO 9 on Yannick. So that's kind of a DI. It's a speaker DI made by Palmer. And it comes straight out of his head. So it's like, it's basically a DI of exactly what's coming out of his head. I like it a lot. And then there's a Toll. And then I think this is a 408. I'm actually not sure right now. Anyway, three different sources for Yannick. And then you'll notice over here, there's a delay. And I think that delay is sourcing from also a Waves thing. Okay, so there's one song in the set that Yannick required some delay to be put on in the house. He didn't really need it in monitors or anything, so I kind of built it out here. So if we go back here, we have a look at Yannick's stuff. There's that, where I'm using H delay on his guitar for that one song. And then here is his bus. I'm using the LA3A. And then for him, I needed a little bit of F6 going on. There must have been something in there that I just needed in addition to the C6. Here's his C6. So C6, you know, looking pretty normal, whatever, a little bit of EQ, much like the other ones. But I added an F6. I think there's something a little bit weird going on at this frequency. 1K-ish. There must have been something that needed a little extra dip that I wasn't getting out of the C6. So that's that. That's Yannick stuff. So that's all the guitars. Those are three guitars, and making three guitars, you know, work together is difficult, but can be done. And that's how that stuff is. Let's take a look at like output buses, like my band bus and my master bus. Now on this band bus, I have a couple of inserts. Or one insert and a couple of plugins. So if we go and look over here, here is the band. Let's see what I have on there. So the first plugin that I have is the API 2500. You know, this plugin and this analog device is gotta be one of my favorite compressors of all time. It's just an amazing compressor. The thrust function of this is really good. But just like, man, it's beefy and, you know, I don't know how to describe it. It's almost always on my band bus. Then right after that is a C6 that is just kind of tickling things. You'll notice the thresholds are pretty high. Maybe just overall band compressing a little bit more at 4K, looks like. And then I have an F6 on this, and the F6, it's kind of hard to see, but basically I am sidechaining from the vocal. Let's see if I can see where it's coming from. So from the Digi 33, bus 33, it's coming from, and where that is from, just so you can see where that comes from, that comes from, sorry, this side, and vocals, it comes from Bruce's, if I can open it, what's going on, weird, it comes from Bruce's direct out. Oh, okay, there we go. So you'll see here, see where it says waves 33 on his direct out, and the direct out is on. So the side chain of the band bus is getting a send from Bruce's vocal. We come back over to here and you'll see that's where that side chain 33 is in the rack of it, or sorry, in the F6 only. I'm compressing a little bit threshold at 1K, the overall band bus, but you'll notice that it's in mid side. All right. So what that does is every time that the vocal happens, it compresses just a little bit at 1K, but only in the center of the mix, not in the outside of the mix. It doesn't touch any of the outside. So it only makes space in the center of the mix, just about a 3 dB cut of vocal at 1K with a kind of wide Q. It just makes space for your vocal. It's really amazing. Like, try it, man. I'm telling you, the mid-side feature on the F6 with the band and it triggered from the vocal, I do that almost with every band. So those are the nuts and bolts of it, just so that you can see it. So there, that's the band bus. Let's have a look, see at the record and the master bus. Let's look at my master bus. So you realize that the band bus and then the vocal bus, are what end up, in the master bus. Okay. So there's a vocal bus and a band bus right here. I don't have anything on the vocal bus. It's just sourcing from all of the vocals, getting to this group, and then it ends up in the overall master bus. Okay, so two things going there, band and mass and vocal bus, end up in the master bus. This master bus has a C6 on it. I don't do a whole lot of stuff with my master bus. It tickles a little. It's really not doing any more than 3 or 4 dB of compression at any point. If you look, all my thresholds are kind of high. It's kind of just sitting there tickling. It's acting as a mastering device, is what I would call it. So anyway, that's what's on my master bus. I know a bunch of you have wondered what was on my master bus, and really, I don't treat the master as a place to fix my mix. So there's not a bunch of plugins and, like, you know, a bunch of tools happening in my master bus. I really try to work on things prior to the master bus, and the master bus plugins for me are pretty simple. Not a whole lot going on there. So then right next to it is the record bus, and that is in this band, it's a copy. It looks like almost exactly the copy of the master bus. Yeah, it is. All right, so I think we've looked at my master and my records. Keys, are just a key stereo channel that I use Renaissance Axe on and a little bit of C6. So there's a couple of songs that have keys in them. A couple of vocal verbs. One of my large vocal verbs, I use H reverb. Pretty great sending, almost 3 seconds of reverb, and let's see, 100 milliseconds of pre-delay. So that's a big reverb. I use that on a couple of songs like ballads. Background vocal width, I really like this plugin, Doubler. It's just a really good plugin for kind of making things be wider. So I'm using that. And finally, let's talk about vocals. I would say that, you know, Bruce is, he is probably one of the best singers that I've ever worked with, and he does not require a lot of stuff going on his vocal. I treat his vocal kind of as mastering, and it looks a little bit like I have a fair amount of plugins. I have got 5 different plugins on there, but they are, all 5 of them are kind of doing just little things. So let's have a look at that. Over here, you know, Digital Land, the same kind of thing. You'll see that Bruce's vocal has an insert on it. There it is. And we go back over here and we look at it. And the first plugin in his chain is PSE. It's my favorite plugin on any vocal, lead vocal, background vocal. It's really, really great. It's a frequency dependent vocal gate. It's awesome. Use it. Check it out. I use it on him and it works perfectly. One of my favorite overall compressors on a vocal previously to plugins was the LA-2A. So when I came to plugins, the CLA-2A, it's a model of the same one and sounds fantastic. It's one of my favorite overall compressors on vocals. And then after that is the C6. You'll notice I have a little bit of EQ going on there, it's not crazy, you know? And there's, you know, some compression that just tickles his vocal, but it's no more than 60 dB of compression. You'll notice that I'm kind of using the plugin to try to cut out all the lows. Although on the channel itself, you'll also see that there's a little bit of EQ too, and low pass and high pass filtering. Let's come back here. The F6 RTA is, you know, it's tickling some things. It's not crazy. If this had signal going through it, you would see there's like just little notches in frequencies that are just kind of tickling and helping to kind of master his vocal. I really like the combination of the C6 and the F6 kind of working together, F6 being way more precision oriented. Try that in your chain, F6 to C6 or vice versa. And then finally, just a DeEsser on the end, just to get rid of some of his super S's. You'll notice it's at 6K. That's it. On his vocal, it's really nothing crazy. Let's look here. Their Adrian vocal and Steve vocal have different things on them. Adrian's, I got a PSE first. Then a vocal rider. I really like that on background vocals in particular. I like it. It expands and compresses really well, and it has no kind of timbre change when it's compressing. It's a good little device. And then C6, pretty standard C6 thing going on there. It looks like there's a little bit of expansion and compression. Steve Harris vocal. Same thing. It starts though with the CLA-76. I don't have a PSE on his vocal, and that is because he doesn't sing as often and doesn't have in Adrian's vocal. The reason the PSE is on there is because the guitar cabinet is blowing right into his vocal. Steve's vocal is a little bit off to the center of his bass cabinet, and so I'm able to get away without the PSE. So that's why it's not there. CLA 76 into a vocal rider into a C6. So pretty straight ahead stuff. So you know what? I think that's about it. That is really what's going on here. If you haven't tried Super Rack, man, it is so awesome. You know, poke around with it. There's all kinds of stuff. It does, you know, like the same kind of things that multi-rack does, but it's just way more kind of user friendly. If you look at like the patching of it, you know, it shows you things very easily, like where stuff is, this Digico to Digico. The setup page is way easier, showing you the Digico card, a server here, and then what controllers I have going on here. Thanks for stopping by and coming to see me. Make sure that you subscribe to this YouTube channel, and we sure do appreciate you stopping by. Thanks.